My name is James Williams Jr. Welcome to Come for Havoc number 2. This is act 2 of my one-man show. See the clothes have changed? Now, I deleted the original copy of what I was doing with this, so we're not even going to give you a recap of that. Just watch the other video. I'm going to go right into it, because I just deleted what I was going to say, because I didn't like how I was going, and I left a day off of this story. So, let's start again. I was about to have the best week ever. Sorry. I screwed that up again. I was having an alright week. Because I was about to change things for me for the rest of my natural life. Or at least, I thought it was. So, we're on a school bus home. It's Monday. One of my best friends, initials CN, we are about to have a big old fight. So Sunday night, I and another student on the bus, her initials are A and M. And we're on the bus and we're discussing, because I thought I was the only one who watched the show, about how your fingernails and your teeth are dead skin. It's just hardened to a harder degree than your actual full skin. Scientists proved it and all that crap on the show that we watched on PBS. And so, me and her was discussing it. She had her own issues, I had my own issues, but anyway, that's not important. What's important is that me and CN got into it. Because we used to play cops and robbers every day, and I was always the cop, he was always the robber. And when we got into this argument, he decided to tell me that I wasn't human, that I was a mutant, or that I was a freak. Henceforth, I love the X-Men. Anyway, so he's talking all this crap about me not being human this and not being human that. And my mom was home and everything. And our moms got along, and we got along. And he's one of those friends that I fought almost every week. You know, and I literally fought him almost every week. I do love you, CN. Anyway, so I go and get his gear out of my house. And he called me a freak one more time. So I took this handful of dirt and I'm scooping it in his backpack. So what he did to me, I deserved it, because I shouldn't have been scooping the dirt in his backpack. I got my ass up in the air and I'm head down, ass up. You know, I'm just scooping dirt in his backpack. I show him what a freak can do. So he put his foot in my ass and he launched me. So my face hit the dirt. And all hell broke loose. I was in a push-up position. Or for all of us in the Army, I was in a front leaning rest position. I sprung up. And my knees never hit the ground or anything. You know, like, you're down. No. I went straight from the front leaning rest into a spinning back kick. And I gave him a spinning back kick. We got to fighting. I won the fight. I gave him his backpack. I went home. Because we were right in front of my house. By the time I got in the house, his mom had called my mom. And I got in trouble. I did have to apologize. I'm also apologizing again, CN, for giving everyone this story. It's not like anybody's really listening. After all, I do gratefully only have 21 followers. But anyway, so the next day is the day, well, I'm on the bus, and these two guys are picking on the white bus driver. Now, everybody on the bus, except for maybe one white kid and another mixed kid besides myself, was on the bus. And they're calling her all kinds of really derogative white names and B-words, and I guess back then white people were like still scared of black people, and especially the kids, or they didn't want to deal with the kids' moms. And so I stood up. You know, I suffer from this thing called superhero syndrome. It's a real disease, trust me. More of us have it than you think. So I stood up and started talking. And a friend of mine on the bus, his initials is PS, and the two guys I'm about to deal with, one of them's initial was a J, like mine, and the other initial was a C. Two different guys. I don't know their last name, so you have to go with first initials. So they decided they're going to kick my ass. And PS decided that that wouldn't be a good idea because I know karate. And he kept telling them, y'all don't want to mess with him. He knows karate. He'd be in the backyard practicing day after day after day. In the back of my head, I'm scared of shit because I never fought two people before at the same time. So I never thought that I could win, but I won't just go sit there and take an ass beating. And I told him, when we get off the bus, we can go ahead and do this because the bus stops at my house. That way, if they whoop my ass, I could just crawl to the house, you know. And as good as I was, I didn't think I was great. You know, I just knew I could handle myself with the one-on-one, but I didn't think I could beat two people at the same time. So, PS, had got these guys' heart. And when we got off the bus, I thought they were going to beat me up. But they jetted, which was cool. And that ended that. All right. So, Wednesday went by. Didn't have a problem. Didn't have a problem at all. That whole Wednesday. Now, at school, it was like a lucky day. Like I got hit by a lightning bolt from Zeus, and no one could touch me. So, didn't get any problems at all. Thursday came along. Didn't have any problems until I got home from school. Now, the brother from Tuesday, Jay, didn't have his partner, C, with him. But his younger brother, whose initial starts with a P, me and my friend DH were playing wrestling. And he happened to pick Sting, so I was stuck with my second favorite choice, which is Reggie Ronnie Garvin, and Hands of Stone. So while we're playing wrestling, P and his three cronies, it was like a three-on-two match, or a four-on-two match. I think the fourth guy might have just been the ref. So we're playing on a pissy mattress and everything, and they wouldn't let me make the tag. So they were jumping me, and I was reaching for my tag, and DH was like, "Did you forget that you know Kung Fu?" And I said, "No, but Ronnie Garvin doesn't use Kung Fu in the ring. Man, get out of character." So I got out of character, and that's when all the problems started. So I shook the first three guys off me. And then the fourth guy, who initially was a P, I had to kick him in the gut because he just would not let go. He had like a pit bull grip. So, or if you're a G.I. Joe fan, he had a Kung Fu grip. And he wouldn't let go. So I thrust kicked him. And he got off me. And he went and picked up the biggest stick he could find. And I picked up an iron pipe. Now, we didn't get to use these instruments, but I was goading him to hit me. I said, "You go ahead and hit me, because I'm going to kill you with this pipe." So that pretty much ended that. And then came Fateful Friday, the day that changed my life in West Haven forever. So, you know, I'm a really short guy. I'm only 5'3". At the time that this was happening, I might have only been about 5 foot even, maybe 5'1", if we're touching on the surface of accuracy. So there was this big dude, and his initials are A and J. Really big guy. We're friends now, but this is my life, it's my victory, and I can tell it the way it's supposed to be told. Him and I had some issues before where he actually thought I was a dead body and put his foot on my head, and that's how our rivalry started right there. From the jump, I knew that him and I would clash one day. If he would have clashed that day, he might have won, because I wasn't prepared for a fight. But from that day, I learned that I needed to prepare for a fight every day. So that was like months before. And then when the day finally came, which was Fateful Friday, there was this incident at home. And it all started with one of my siblings. Her initial starts with the G. No, not that one. Because two of my sisters' names start with the G. Well, anyway, the evil G, or the evilest of the G's, decided that she could hit me with a handful of rocks. And for some reason, the spirit of Hermes got into her that day. Because as quick as the flash was, I could not catch her. So God had to be controlling them feet. And I finally caught her when we got to the big children's park. I just grabbed her. And the initials AJ decided to get a handful of those rubber things and rocks and hit me. And them damn things hurt. So I let her go and I said, "I will deal with you in a second." Now, when a guy is sitting down, they don't really seem to be all that damn tall. Yeah. Never punch a guy while he's sitting down. It's like not the best idea that you can have, as I will continue. So I walked over to him and, you know, me thinking that I was a badass and knowing that secretly I'm not. You know, I became a badass that day, though. And I was wearing McGregor golf cleats while I was doing it. Shout out to McGregor golf cleats because they saved my ass, as the story will continue. So I went over to him, and I don't know what the hell I was thinking, man. I asked the little fucker. Well, he was a little while he was sitting down. We were about the same size. And I said, motherfucker, what's your motherfucking problem, dude? And then I did the one thing that I've never done in my life. I hit first. So I tagged him. I said, BOW! You know, and that with a regular uppercut, but like that sideways shit, so you know you're gonna do some damage. Yeah. Bad idea. He shook that shit off. Shit didn't even hurt him. And when he stood up, he pushed me. And I slid back a few feet. And I looked at myself. And I looked at this motherfucker. And the first thing I thought was, it's me. That's my soul jumping out my body, looking at me and saying, you's a dumbass motherfucker. What the fuck did you do that for? And then it kind of played out like a movie. So he ran at me. I took my kung fu stance. You know, this right leg. Said, pow, boom. Didn't hurt him. And then I'm thinking to myself, this motherfucker's gonna kill me. If I don't do something brass, I'm gonna fucking die today. And so the fear of dying can make you do things that would seem totally impossible. Know thy enemy and know thyself, and you will never know defeat in battle. Most importantly, know thyself so that you'll know how much of a fight you can take and when to get the hell out of Dodge. Well, the park was enclosed, so there was no getting the hell out of Dodge. And AJ decided he was going to kill me. So I knew that he had asthma. Because he had an asthma attack a few months before the fight. Like a lot of people, I'm nosy, but I don't be nosy intentionally. So when he came at me, I knew that kicks didn't work. I had to induce an asthma attack. And he was like 300 pounds. And I'm like maybe a buck soaking wet. He was way bigger than me, way taller than me. And the odds of me winning was slim to none. And slim just took off. And none weren't even in town while it was happening. So he's coming at me like a big fucking grizzly bear, right? And I'm like, God, I'm gonna die, I'm gonna die, I'm gonna fucking die. So I start tagging him in the gut. Now, what I remember and what people have told me are two different things. I remember only throwing left hands, and I remember only throwing three of them. I only hit him in the face the two times at the beginning of the fight. When I punched him the first time and he stood up, and I realized that I was fighting Gargantuan. And when I kicked him with my McGregor cloth cleats, and none of that shit fazed his ass. None of it. He was tough as fucking nails. And I was a scared little bitch boy. But I was a scared little bitch boy who knew how to fight. And I had been in the fights all that week. Which is where the thing is about to take a turn for the worse for me. So, he's fading back, you know, and I'm steadily driving these damn lefts into him. And when he's fading back, I guess he was getting ready to collapse, but I wasn't sure what he was going to do. So he dropped down and grabbed my right leg, and about that time, he had company. I will leave out what she was in relation to him, but let's just say he had company, who grabbed my arm and started pulling me this way. He's got my leg and pulling me this way. I'm a heartbeat from hitting the ground. And so my hand, many martial artists can tell you that if you ever felt chi power, you know that it could be dangerous to use it. My hand felt like it was on fire. It felt like somebody set this whole damn thing on fire. I could feel the burning all the way up my motherfucking arm. And it was just like, hit her, hit her, hit her. But I was raised not to hit girls. I was also raised not to hit women and respect my elders. So I couldn't. This shit would not leave the chamber. It was locked and loaded. It just would not fire. She's pulling me this way. He's pulling me this way. And then I remembered that I was wearing McGregor golf cleats. So my foot became my weapon. It became my pendulum of strength. And that shit just kept going. Wham, 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 wham. And I won't stop it. And he won't bleeding. So I won't stop it. Again, he was not bleeding by any means necessary. He was tough as nails. About that time, the cop showed up. His name I will reveal because he is currently deceased. And once you're deceased, there is no coming back from being deceased. Or at least not in the body that you currently own. So, he grabs the woman, gets her off me, gets between me and him, gets his hands off my leg. I put my other foot down, picks him up, dust him off, like cleans him completely off. All the dirt and everything that was on him from all that rubbery, gravelly crap. I mean, he completely dusted them off and sent them on their way home. Now, mind you, as I told you before, if you were paying attention, Monday I got the fighting, Tuesday I got the fighting, Thursday I got the fighting, and Fateful Friday I got the fighting. Now, I mean, I got my days mixed up, but I know I got the fighting almost every day that week. So, apparently it got back to Officer Granger, who never liked me anyway, and he decides to jump down my throat. Now, here's where life takes an interesting turn. So he's all up in my face, jumping down my throat, and I was like, hey, man, he hit me with the rocks first. Sure, he hit you with the rocks first. You've been fighting all week long. I've been hearing about you. I just ain't been able to catch you every time you done got into one of these fights because you know that kung fu shit. I was like, well, he started it. He didn't have to hit me with the rocks. I was fixing to hurt my sister, not him. So then Granger's chewing me out and everything. And then he says, if you get into one more fight, and it was Friday, so I had like two more days that I could fight. If you get into one more fight this week, I will have you and your family evicted. And I'm not supposed to do this, but I did it anyway because I was raised better than what I'm about to say I did. But it's a confession. I give you guys the whole 99.9. So I licked the big fat bastard in the face and said, fuck you, buddy. But I didn't use the buddy part. I actually called him by his name and told him, we fucking moving anyway. The funny part is, I had no fucking idea we were moving. I know that I was going away the next week or so to my dad's for the summer. I didn't know when I came back I wouldn't be coming back to the projects. So, he looked at me, he laughed, he walked away. And all of a sudden, everybody who's ever said that I wasn't shit, that I couldn't fight my way out of a wet paper bag with holes in it, that I didn't know karate, and that I was fake, and I was a big-ass phony, all those motherfuckers in the projects started flocking to me. You the shit, motherfucker. You the karate kid like a motherfucker. Nah, he the last dragon. Whoa! So, and then I was Kung Fu Joe for a while. But anyway, because I'm going to get you sucker came out. So, I'm all these names, and now they're no longer using them as ways to insult me. They're using them as ways to praise me. I had people who hated my guts asking me to teach them the shit that I know. So, like I said, it was Fateful Friday. And after that, me and AJ, we became friends. I had to apologize to him. He apologized to me. But it didn't happen, like, until we seen each other again on the streets and everything. He never ever bothered me again after that. And I was always scared that he would. So, you know, I'll be the first to tell you, when we fought, the only person in that whole fight that was scared was me. He wasn't scared because he was relying on his size. I was scared because I was scared of his size. But after that day, I have never, ever, 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 ever been scared of anyone bigger than me. Ever again. Ever. So thank you for that, AJ. But, you know, it wasn't a lesson that I wanted to learn that way. You know, I thought that I sucked at martial arts until that week. I honestly, truly, God did. Then after that confidence booster, that was all she wrote. Now, mind you, before that, way back like 3 years before that, when I was 12, I was fighting because I didn't have a choice. That was one of those times where I didn't have a choice, and it was fight or die. So, yeah, I was like, yeah, this is bad. You know, it was real bad. Because like I said, he towered above me and he outweighed me by two people. So it wasn't like I really had a win in my pocket on that one. I honestly truly expected to die that day, which is probably why I survived. And I still have those McGregor golf cleats to this day. I have never thrown them away, even though I've outgrown them. I will never throw them away. They will probably be cremated with me when I die. Because you can't take anything with you. But knowing that that I could beat someone three times my size gave me a renewed confidence. But there was that one person that I could not beat, which was my mom. So when I went to high school, the bullying picked right back up where it started. Those same people that wanted to learn martial arts from me, some of them were there and some of them picked on me. And it continued into high school and to the 11th grade where some of those same people, as I told you in the other video, they know who they are. Those motherfuckers realized one thing for sure. When I snapped in class, that was it. They were gonna die. I didn't give a shit. So Columbine really didn't have that much on me. except for they use machine guns, and I prefer to use these machine guns. And, you know, if I've offended anybody with that Columbine thing, I apologize. But, you know, this is a true story. And this was, like, way before Columbine. Columbine happened in, like, 99, so it was, like, 10 years before Columbine even happened. Because I said 89, I was going into high school, you know. Because you go 89, 90, that's 1 year. 90, 91, that's two. 93, 92, 93, yeah. So it might have been 87. So I know I went into high school between 88 and 89. And then I graduated in 93. But I know you do 4 years of high school. The years kind of are like, I guess, split because you get into the new year in the middle of school or whenever the hell the 12th month comes. Y'all know how the goddamn system works. Anyway, so after that, you know, I went to work. I got a job at Little Caesars. And I was exceptionally homophobic. And one day my bosses sent me to Roses to go buy some fans. To those young men of the alternative lifestyle, if you remember me, I apologize for my actions. I am no longer homophobic. I understand your lifestyle now because I actually grew up and talked to people who live the alternative lifestyle. So I understand that shit now. But way back when I was 15, working at Little Caesars, I didn't know shit. I was 15. And most 15-year-old kids, you know what the fuck you're taught. That's pretty much it. So that was my prejudice, me right there. So to those young male men of alternate lifestyle living, I apologize. Only for my actions, because you can't take anything back once you say it. It's done. It's never going back down your throat. So I went to Roses because we had to buy... they wanted a square fan, and all they sold at Roses was ceiling fans. And I've had some really bad alternative lifestyle experiences that I would probably not share unless I'm going to get paid for it. Well, anyway, so I come back, I chew out my boss, and a couple of months after that, I get a job at Kegler's. And at Kegler's is where the guy kept calling me chief. So I met this one guy, and I was doing kung fu outside on my lunch break. And, I would show him something for weeks and weeks and weeks, and then he seemed to come to Kegler's every fucking weekend, so we were cool. But then, maybe it was like a year or two into me working at Kegler's when I met him. Because I was between 17 and 18 when I met him. And one night, he decides that he wants to show me to his friends. The problem is, his friends were a little bit redneckish. That's what they call some of the white races around here in Virginia. And they caught me a lot of boys. So, it was like my last trash dump before the night was over. It was a Saturday night. And, you know, I had showed the guy moves that day. Didn't think nothing of it, you know, because, one, if you're a martial artist, you tend to show off a little bit. Those who say they don't, they're lying through their fucking teeth. Because someone wants to do a demonstration, or they know that you know it, so they actually do a demonstration. And I was pretty good at my spinning jump kick, or as Van Damme calls it, the propeller kick. And about that time, Van Damme and them were just coming out. So, you know, I'm doing my thing, idolizing them, doing my thing, showing the guy what I can do. So later that night, when I was dumping out the trash, him, his friend, and their girlfriends all said they're going to come out. I broke the first rule of martial arts. By not paying attention to my surroundings. I broke the second rule of martial arts by trusting people that I don't know very well. And then I broke all the rules of martial arts and street fighting in one whole night. So one guy broke off and they were underage drinking. He went and threw the beer or whatever in the recycling bin. And I didn't think nothing of it. He had a pretty girlfriend. And his friend was the distractor. So he came up and started talking to me. Says, hey, boy, what you gonna do if we beat you up? And I said, well, it ain't the first time I've been beat up. My big sister used to beat my ass all the time. I said, it won't be the last. He said, well, what you gonna do if we beat you up and throw you in that dumpster? I said, you can beat my ass, but you ain't throwing me in that dumpster. About that time, the burly bastard that threw his can in the recycling bin grabbed me with a grip like this. So he grabbed me at my arms and I was pent like this so I couldn't move. And I was like, oh, shit. About that time, the guy had been showing moves like, hey, man, what are y'all doing? No, he think he bad. We could see how bad he really is. I said, hold on. I never said I was bad. We know. But our friend here says that you know karate. You got cool-ass moves. It's like, oh, okay. So he's ragdolling me and shit. And I was like, look, man, I don't want to hurt you. Oh, you ain't going to hurt us. We're going to fuck your black ass up, boy. And we're going to put you in that damn dumpster. I said, okay. If that's how we got to play this, so be it. So I flung myself forward while he was ragdolling me. And we both flipped. He landed on the bottom. So when he landed on the bottom, with my body weight on top, it knocked all his air out. And so then I elbowed him and spent my elbow into his sternum. So he couldn't breathe. He was fighting for air. And I backwards rolled off of him. And this is about the time the Beverly Hillbilly movie came out with Erica Laniak. So I rolled up off of him. And then what I should have done was got on the ground and pound him. But I don't fight like that. I like to keep that shit on my feet. So I was like, I'm going to give you the chance you ain't give me since you want to attack motherfuckers from the back. Get your ass up. Let's go. I never called him a white bastard or anything. I just told him to get his ass up. Now, here's the thing. God must have given girls superpowers. Because how this girl did this is beyond me. Because she was at least 4 feet away from us. And she never ran. I never seen her get a running start at anything. And he couldn't, when he got up, he was staggering. You know, he was like all fucked up and dazed and shit. So I was like, you want to jump me from the back? After I fuck you up, I'm going to fuck up your friend that did all that goddamn talking, and y'all getting in the goddamn dumpster. So I drew my hand back, and I started in. I went in for the full kill. I was going to punch him in his fucking throat, but I was aiming at his face. But my mind was saying, hit him in the throat, hit him in the throat. He already can't breathe. But my fist was a little bit off on aim. I came 1 millimeter from punching a girl in the face, which I swore I would never do again. And I don't know where she came from, because she wasn't close enough to get hit, but it was like she just like teleported right in front of me, and my fist stopped right at her face. I said, look, beautiful, you need to move. Your boyfriend asked for this ass whooping, and I'll be fixing to give it to him. So she wouldn't move. I go to the left, she goes to the right, and she's blocking me. She's crying. I was like, you know what? I never, ever, ever will put my hands on a girl. Ever. So if you just move that way and let me finish this motherfucker off, and then I'm going to go get his best friend here, and y'all can do whatever you want with them. I'm on my job, and y'all want to attack me on my motherfucking job? He's got to pay for this shit. So she cried her way out of me whipping his ass. He got his breath. He apologized. His friend apologized. And they start walking off. The guy that I knew that I showed all the moves to, he's like, dude, I'm real sorry about this. I said, hey, man, it's cool. It's not your fault that you have dumbass friends. It's my fault because I shouldn't have been showing you the shit that I know in the first goddamn place. I don't hold you responsible. I blame myself for that shit. Because at 15, 16, and 17, I was a fucking show-off. Never thought that shit could bite me in the ass. Never. It bit me in the ass. So after him and I shook hands, I said, you tell your friends they better never come near me again. And keep their girlfriends out of my range, too, because next time I won't be nice. So he helped his friend get back to the car, and they drove off, and me and the guy spoke for like another year while I was working there. But this is the best part. One of my coworkers is a big, tall ginger fella. His initials is a C2. And he watched the whole thing. He's like 6'2". I'm 5'3". He's watching these guys who are like 5'8 or better. All the way up at the dumpster at Kegler where I am. And he's all the way at the back door at Kegler's, only on the parking lot side where the handicap wheel is. He's watching this shit as it unfolds. He's watching it as it unfolds as these two white guys tried to jump my ass. And he's just watching this shit. Because he too also thought that I was a fucking phony. So I get down there, right? How you doing? Anyway, I get down there and he's like, dude, you a fucking badass. You really know that karate shit. That was some bad motherfucking shit. I like the part where you threw yourself forward and flipped that dude and you flip back off that dude. That shit was fucking awesome. And I'm thinking to myself, what? So me being me, first thing I said was, you fucking watch this shit? And you didn't come up there to help. Hey, man, you had that shit under control. Your ass is the shit. you ain't need my motherfucking help. And I'm thinking to myself, it was 2-on-1. And he's like, dude, you good. You probably the best I've ever seen. But I didn't do anything. All I did was flip him over and elbow him in the sternum and flip back off of him and give him the chance to fight fairly. So, you know, I didn't think I was that great. I just thought it was just survival instincts kicking in. But apparently, black people and white people view things totally different. Therefore, so I go in there, and the first thing I do is become the biggest bitch ever. I call my mom. I'm sure you guys didn't see that comment, but I call my mom. I'm in there. I'm mad as hell. I'm so mad that tears are, like, trying to form, but they can't. And I'm so ashamed that I won, that I shouldn't be crying, but I want to cry because I got jumped on my job, man. We ain't got no fucking security. I got jumped on my motherfucking job. Does that not, like, sink in with everybody of how I got jumped on my fucking job? So I call my mom, and I'm like, Mom, guess what happened? What? You okay? I'm fine. But I need to quit my job. No, 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 no. You can't quit your job. You will not quit that fucking job. You got a car to pay for. I can get another job. No, no. You're not quitting your motherfucking job. I just got jumped by some white boys out here. Did you win? Yep. Then you're not quitting your job. But they jumped me. You're not quitting your fucking job. Click. And the only thing I could think to myself was, this bitch hung up on me. This isn't my day. So I hung the phone up, madder than a motherfucker. Finished doing my job. Got so mad, went home. Come find out before I could leave that there was a mandatory meeting the next day. So we get there to the mandatory meeting. And of course, C was telling the black guy whose name is the same about the fight I had. It's like, man, y'all, that James, man, that little motherfucker's a badass, yo. He's a fucking badass. Which goes back to white people and black people see things completely different. And I'm sitting there, and I come to this mandatory meeting that has nothing to do with washing dishes, but I'm forced to be here where other people who need to be here aren't there, but it's a mandatory meeting. And we all talking about shit. There's no, James, you need to wash the dishes a little better. Maybe you can scrub them a little harder. There's nothing to do with James at all. Nothing to do with Kent. And nothing to do with the other dishwasher, because there was three of us. I don't know his name because he was Mexican. Kent was black, and I was like the in-between kid. So, we had this wasted time of meeting. Both of the C's talked to me about the fucking fight. And then I go the fuck home, because I have to come back in 2 hours to go the fuck to work. That was when I worked 3 days a week, three days on the weekend, you know. And I got off at like 7 on Sunday. I never worked past 7 on Sunday. But I was pretty shaken up with the stress from working and trying to keep my grades up and shit. But I did work. So, I get home and I explain to my mom, you know, why you won't let me quit? Because on the phone, I left off the part about where I told her I was one of her precious daughters, because she has 5 girls at this time. And I was like, if I was one of your precious daughters, you'd let me quit. She's like, yeah, you're probably right. That's when I knew that I was not ever going to be one of her favorites, ever. So after that, you know, it pretty much was the gist that there's lessons learned there. One, no matter what job you're in, you can tell people you know martial arts, but you should not probably demonstrate, because there's always some asshat that's going to want a piece of you. And two, you should always be more aware of your surroundings when you're working at night, period. Now, as I moved on in life, I got a job as a security guard by the time I was like maybe 2021. Well, this is the final part of this, and I'll give you guys a longer act 3 or whatever. I might make this a 5-act thing. So, I got the job as a security guard. It was called Richmond Security. They were unarmed, which I didn't have a problem with because I don't like guns, and I do know how to fight, so that wasn't a problem. But to get certified, I had to go all the way to Lynchburg. This is where the fun starts. So for 2 days, they got us sitting in this auditorium type area. And things are about to go completely south. We have to watch these videos about this dude who's about my height, who's beating the hell out of people, right? And I'm thinking to myself, I done hit the jackpot with this job. I can fight people. I don't have a gun. He didn't have a gun. He's beating up on people whose asses are way bigger than him. And the place that I'm stationed at, the shortest person in there is 6 feet tall and she's a woman. All the men in there are 6'5" and up. Big country boys, man. And no, I wasn't afraid of them. I was kind of like, yeah. When I go get certified, you know, I'm gonna learn all this stuff. And it wasn't, they didn't even teach us, like, physical hand-to-hand combat, which was kind of strange. You know, you're a security guard. You can't always get to your weapon. They should give you some kind of combatives. And they didn't do that. But they asked all of us if we had a background of some sort in fighting. The fella I went with was either a former cop or had been a security guard. He was getting re-upped, and he had some kind of formal training. He didn't have training in martial arts, but he had some form of training. And everybody else there were private securities. They had forms of training. They had gun licenses, and they were quick draw guys. So we watched these 12 videos in these 2 days, and then we had to take this test on the last day. And at the end of the test, or before the test began, rather, the guy goes, okay, you two guys from Richmond Security, everything you've just watched is now in void. And I'm like 20 years old, so I don't know what the fuck that means. He's like, I said, so what does that mean? He said, you guys are basically hired just for looks. If you touch anyone while you're in uniform, you could be sued. Not just by the person who you hurt, but by Richmond Security itself. And I'm thinking to myself, what? We just watched a video for 2 goddamn days, and you're going to tell me that if somebody in the place that I'm facilitating or protecting decides to wrap their hands around my neck, I can't touch them. I can't call 911 if I'm dead. So it gets even better from there. He also goes, well, also, if you're in your uniform and you're getting coffee at a 7-Eleven, a 7-Eleven is getting robbed, you have to stop it. Now, mind you, in case you missed the first part of this, the unarmed security. I don't recall knowing much about taking guns from people. I did learn that eventually, but at that time I didn't know it. So I'm like, let me get this right. So for $4.25 an hour, if I'm in 7-Eleven and somebody decides they want to rob the place for hot dogs with a gun, I have to take a bullet for 7-Eleven who's not paying me. I said, well, I got a solution for that. I won't wear my uniform anywhere. I'll just keep it in the car. He's like, yeah, that's probably a smart idea, little guy. And, you know, I did that. But then, when he hit us with that null and void shit, I said, there's no way in hell I'm going to survive with this job. I'm the smallest guy in the room. I'm the smallest guy in the building. Even though the shortest woman is bigger than me. This isn't going to work out if she gets pissed off. This isn't going to work out if anyone there gets pissed off because their hands are bigger than my face. Yeah. So I'm kicking myself in the ass now because I could have started my own security company had I thought about this shit back then. And I'm kicking myself in the ass every day for that. So I purposely failed the test. Basically, I wrote abracadabra all the way down the damn page, which I should have not done. I should have got certified and I would have been okay. But no, I chose the opposite. I chose the bitch way out instead of actually trying to take the test because I could have passed the test. It was like multiple choice. Only an idiot could have failed it. Duh. So, in closing, I fucked myself over. And then, come find out, you know, since I didn't get certified, I wasn't supposed to be fired until January. They fired me 2 days before Christmas. Yeah. So then I had to find another job. And at that time, you know, $4.25 wasn't much money, but it was better than nothing. And, you know, it was a step down from when I worked at Kegler because they were paying me $5 an hour. And I left them. I went to Joann Fabric. Almost broke my hand. I've had a whole lot of bad adventures before I hit 25 years old. So, in closing, you know, I have mad things that I can tell you guys, and I could go on all night. But this thing has gone over the 30-minute mark. So I'm going to close out and maybe sleep on Act 3 and what I'm going to tell you and see if you guys like it. Eventually, I'm going to actually write a one-man show. These are samples, and if you guys like them and want to know more war stories and stuff, they're all true. They're not overly exaggerated. If anything, I've left stuff off just so that it wouldn't be overly exaggerated or to the fourth power or whatever. You know, let me know. This is Comfy Havoc number 2. Be seeing you.